द स्केलेटल सिस्टम ऑफ इनवर्टिब्रेट्स एंड वर्टिब्रेट्स. द स्केलेटल सिस्टम्स एज ऑर्गेनिज्म इवॉल्व फ्रॉम द एंसेस्ट्रल प्रोटेस्ट टू द मल्टीसेलुलर एनिमल्स बॉडी साइज इंक्रीज ड्रामेटिकली. As you know that protists are the ancestors of all multicellular organism. Here you see that the multicellular eukaryotic animals were evolved from the protists. So during this evolution, the body size of animals increased dramatically. Systems involved in movement and support evolved simultaneously with the increase in body size. The skeletal systems. Organisms have three kinds of skeletons: fluid hydrostatic skeletons, rigid exoskeletons, and rigid endoskeletons. These skeletal systems also function in animal movement that require muscles working in opposition to each other. The skeletal system of invertebrates. Invertebrates have three types of skeletons: hydrostatic skeletons, exoskeletons, and endoskeletons. Hydrostatic skeleton. The skeleton of the body, which is produced due to fluid filled within the gastrovascular or ciliomic cavity, is called hydrostatic skeleton. The hydrostatic skeleton is a core of liquid. That liquid may be water or another body fluid like blood, surrounded by a tension resistant sheath of longitudinal and circular muscles. Invertebrates use their body fluids for internal support. The hydrostatic skeleton is an excellent adaptation in invertebrates. It is based on efficient principles of hydrodynamics. Hydrostatic skeleton is present in different invertebrates like sea anemone and earthworm. Hydrostatic skeleton of sea anemone. Hydrostatic skeleton of sea anemone is composed of incompressible liquid. And this liquid fluid is surrounded by tension resistant sheath. Like here you see in this diagram, this is the fluid or a liquid which is surrounded by tension resistant sheath, and this sheath is made up of longitudinal and circular muscles. It is similar to a water filled balloon because the force exerted against the incompressible fluid in one region can be transmitted to the other regions. Contracting muscles push against a hydrostatic skeleton and the transmitted force generates the body movement. Like here, as you see that this is a sea urchin, a sea anemone, and it is moving. The hydrostatic skeleton of sea anemone allows them to shorten or close when the longitudinal muscles contract, or to lengthen or open when circular muscles contract. Like in this diagram here, you see that here the body fluid or the volume of the body fluid like blood or any other body fluid is constant. Volume of fluid is constant. A change like increase in width, as here, this increase in width must accompany a decrease in length, like this. And when this width is decreased, the length is increased. So in this way this animal move. I'm repeating this, that hydrostatic skeleton of sea anemone allows them to shorten or close when longitudinal muscles contract, or to lengthen or open when circular muscles contract. Hydrostatic skeleton in earthworm. Earthworm is composed of longitudinal and circular muscle, or you say you can say that earthworm has longitudinal and circular muscles. Earthworm contracts its longitudinal and circular muscles alternatively, creating a rhythm that moves the earthworm through the soil. The hydrostatic skeleton keeps the body from collapsing when its muscle contract. The invertebrate hydrostatic skeleton can take many forms and shapes. These include gastrovascular cavity of acoelomates, rhynchocele in nematines, pseudocoelom in ascalmanthes, coelom in annelids, and hemocoel in mollusks. gastrovascular cavity of a coelomate, this is a sea urchin, and in sea urchin gastrovascular cavity can act as a hydrostatic skeleton. Rhynchocoel in nematines, this is a terrestrial nematine, and here the rhynchocoel can act as a hydrostatic skeleton. Pseudocoelom in escalmens, this is the photo of an ascaris, and in this ascaris the pseudocoelom can act as a hydrostatic skeleton. Coelom in annelids, this is the photo of an earthworm, and in earthworm or in annelids coelom can act as a hydrostatic skeleton. Hemocoel in mollusk can act as hydrostatic skeleton. Although mollusk are coelomates, their coelom are reduced to fairly small spaces enclosing the heart and gonads. The main body cavity is a hemocoel, through which blood and coelomic fluid circulate, and which encloses most of the other internal organs. These coelomic hemocoelic spaces act as an efficient hydrostatic skeleton. Here the feet of burrowing bivalve, and this the feet of burrowing bivalve is example of hydrostatic skeleton in mollusks. Exoskeletons. The skeleton in which skeleton is present outside the muscles is called exoskeleton. Functions of exoskeleton. Rigid exoskeleton have locomotor functions, because they provide sites for muscle attachment and counter forces the muscle movement. Exoskeletons also support and protect the body. Functions of exoskeleton. In arthropods, as you have learned in previous lectures, that arthropods, the epidermis or the body wall of arthropods secretes a thick hard cuticle, and this cuticle waterproofs the body. So cuticle makes the body waterproof. The cuticle also protects and supports the animal's soft internal organs. In crustacean, for example, in crabs, lobsters and shrimps, the exoskeleton contains calcium carbonate crystals that make it hard and inflexible except at the joints. In arthropods, exoskeleton provides shield-like protection from enemies. It is resistant to general wear and tear. The exoskeleton also prevents internal tissues from drying out. Exoskeleton, this important evolutionary adaptation contributed to arthropods' successful colonization of land. So, exoskeleton is a very important evolutionary adaptation for arthropods. Exoskeleton also has a disadvantage, as it limits an animal's growth. Exoskeleton hinders the animal's growth, therefore some animals shed the exoskeleton periodically, as arthropods do when they molt. This is the photo of discarded exoskeleton of grasshopper. Exoskeleton at joints. Certain regions of the arthropod body have thin flexible cuticle, and joints are usually in these areas. Exoskeleton at joints, it is in these areas that pairs of antagonistic muscles function through a system of levers to produce coordinated movement. Here you see that this is the segment of a limb of an arthropod, and it is the body valve. The exoskeleton is attached to the interior, the muscles. Here you see that these are the muscles, and these muscles are attached to the interior of exoskeleton. This is exoskeleton. So in arthropods, muscle attached to the interior of exoskeleton. In this articulation of arthropod limb, the cuticle is hardened everywhere except at the joints, where the membrane is flexible. Here you can notice that the extensor muscle, this is the extensor muscle and this is the flexor muscle. Notice that extensor muscle is antagonistic to the flexor muscle. Antagonistic means that it works in an opposite direction. So extensor muscle is antagonistic to the flexor muscle. Interestingly, some arthropod joints, for example the wing joints of flying beetles and the joints of fleas involved in jumping, possess a highly elastic protein called animal rubber or resilin. From an evolutionary perspective, the development of a jointed flexible exoskeleton that permitted flight is one of the reasons for the success of arthropods. Endoskeletons. The skeleton in which skeleton is present inside the muscles is called endoskeleton. The endoskeleton of sponges. Endoskeleton of sponges consists of mineral spicules and fibers of sponge that keep the body from collapsing. Here in this photo you can see these are spongin fibers and here these are spicules. Since the adult sponges attach to the substrate, they have no need for muscles attached to the endoskeleton. The endoskeleton of echinoderms. Endoskeleton of echinoderms like sea star and sea urchin consist of small calcareous plates called ossicles. Mineralized tissues and the invertebrates. Hard mineralized tissues are also present in invertebrates. Hard mineralized tissues are not unique to the vertebrates. In fact, over 2/3 of the living species of animals that contain mineralized tissues are invertebrates. Most invertebrates have inorganic calcium carbonate crystals embedded in a collagen matrix. Here you see that this is the photo of a cnidarian polyp and it has calcium carbonate skeleton. Some invertebrates have cartilage. Cartilage is the supportive tissue. It makes up the major skeletal component of some gastropods. This is the photo of a snail, which is a gastropod, and this is the feeding apparatus of a generalized gastropod. Here you see this is the odontophore. Odontophore is a cartilaginous projection in the mouth of a mollusk on which radula is supported. It is a cartilage that underlies and support the radula, a ribbon of teeth. Here you see that this is the ribbon of teeth and this is the odontophore. So by moving the radula and odontophore over a surface, the teeth cut and scoop up food particles and convey them into the mouth. Summary of today's lecture. In this lecture we studied about the skeletal system of invertebrates. Invertebrates have three types of skeletons. These include hydrostatic skeletons, exoskeletons and endoskeletons. Hydrostatic skeleton, the skeleton of the body which is produced due to fluid filled within gastrovascular or coelomic cavity is called hydrostatic skeleton and it is present in sea anemone and earthworm. Exoskeleton, the skeleton in which skeleton is present outside the muscle and it is found in arthropods. Endoskeleton, the skeleton in which skeleton is present inside the muscles is called endoskeleton and it is found in sponges and echinoderms. Mineralized tissues are also present in invertebrates like in the form of inorganic calcium carbonate crystals and cartilage.